Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Baptist. We are so excited to be gathering this morning for worship, and it's good to be together, whether you are here in person or joining us online. I hope that you're a visitor. If you're a visitor, you will feel particularly welcomed this morning. We'd love for you to fill out one of the welcome cards here in the sanctuary. They're in the pew rack in front of you, and you can drop it in one of the offering plates as you leave so that we can follow up. Or if you're online, just leave us a comment or send us a message so that we can know that you are with us today. Many of you may have noticed that we have installed a new sound system here in our sanctuary. So there are speakers throughout the sanctuary. There are microphones here in the choir loft now. And we want to thank our online worship team, our AV team, for all the hard work that they have done making this a reality and then adjusting to this new reality as we join together in worship. I want to direct your attention to some, yes, very good. I want to direct your attention to some announcements in your bulletin. Our weekly activities continue this week with our Ageless Adventurers Walk on Tuesday morning, our Thursday morning study, as well as our Thursday chancel handbell and choir rehearsal. I'll lead Wednesday morning Bible study online via Zoom, and then there will be a Bible study for all ages on Wednesday evening. You also see a few new opportunities for us to engage in mission and service. Sponsored by our Women on Mission, you can join in our game night or in the Salvation Army bell ringing, and you can find more information there in your bulletin. We also have a green team that is beginning, and so read about that and find ways that you can be involved. I encourage you to pick up a copy of the proposed 2022 budget in the Narthex if you haven't already, as we prepare for our budget discussion after our 11 o'clock worship service next Sunday. So mark your calendars for that. And remember our October and November mission focus as a church body as we continue to raise funds for medical debt relief in our area. We have so many good things coming up, ways that you can be involved in the life and ministry of our church, from worship to discipleship, service, and prayer, and I hope that you will find ways to use your gifts and your time in ministry with us. I'd like to invite Jim Spangler up to share a little bit about what's going on next door.
Good morning. As you can see, next door, we've just about completed the north wall brick, and the south wall, which you cannot see from here on the other side, is about 50% completed, and that's because it rained last week and they didn't get it done. But this week, looks like the weather's good. They should finish the south wall and the west wall, which is on the parking lot. Under the portico next door, the concrete has been poured to receive the bricks that we are going to have engraved. So that's ready to go when the bricks are ready. Key Construction has sent crews to continue demolition on the inside in the old fellowship hall. They have recently just removed the ceiling tiles and the insulation and the in the wall air conditioning unit that's on the south side, not on the north side yet. They're working on that. They've also used cinder block to fill up some old doorways, and they've also cut a number of new doorways, including the entrance and the exit to the food serving line in the new kitchen. So they continue to make good progress and be on schedule in there. Now, we've been promising to have a walkthrough so you all can see and feel what's actually going on in there. So we now have a date, and it's November 28th, and that day we have one service, and that is the day of First Sunday of Advent, and it's Lessons and Carols. So I invite you people that are on Zoom as well, if you can possibly come and be here live and be a part of that service, and then we'll have a tour afterwards. Again, I thank you for your monetary gifts, but I also thank you for your prayers and your support and your patience. Thank you very much.
And now, if you'll join me in our call to worship, I ask that you to stand if you are able. How wonderful it is to be in a dwelling place for God. There is a place here for everyone. No one is turned away.
The least and the lost, the hungry and homeless are always welcome in God's house.
Praise to God who invites all and shelters us all.
Praise
be to God who heals and sends us forth to serve. Amen.
Join me now in singing our hymn of praise, number 396, For Such a Time as This. I invite you to turn with me for our first scripture reading, the epistle reading, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 14 through 18. And we urge you, brothers, warn those who are idle, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone, make sure that nobody pays wrong for wrong, but always try to be kind to each other and to everyone else. Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Amen.
I'd like to invite all the children to come down for the children's story. Good morning. I have a question for you guys. Which one of you knows everything about everything? Nobody? Nobody knows all the answers? Okay. So if we don't have all the answers, sometimes we need help. So who in our lives can we ask for help? God, you guys, I'm telling you, these kids, first off the bat, 8:30 service too, got the right answer. So in our lives, we have our parents and other adults and our teachers that can help us, but God will always be there to help us. And what is a way that we can ask God for help? Zoe? We can pray. And we can pray in a crowded, loud room. We can pray at night in our bed. We can pray anywhere at any time because God will always hear us and he will always listen and help. So let's have a prayer and you can go back to your seats or with me to Bible Friends. Lord, we thank you so much for all the help you give us in our lives. We thank you for listening when we pray in our happiest moments and those when we need you the most. Amen.
Thank you, handbells. It's nice to see some new members up there. That was beautiful. Will you join me now in a time of prayer? Eternal and loving God, today we thank you for the gift of prayer, the opportunity to come into your presence, aware of the ways that you are with us in the very midst of our lives. We give you thanks for the ways that you listen to us when we pray, and the ways that you speak to our hearts as well. Today we hear your invitation to lead lives that are shaped by prayer, lives that are shaped by our connection with you. And so we ask you to teach us how to pray, so that we might learn how to come to you with our whole selves, honest and without pretense. Forgive us today for the ways we have turned our backs on you, for the ways that we have hurt others. And give us the courage, Lord, to forgive those who have wronged us as well. Teach us how to trust that your grace is sufficient for each day, as we give thanks for and share the things we have been given. Help us to love you with our whole hearts as we learn how to love our neighbors as ourselves. And as our prayers build bridges between us and you, we ask that our eyes would be alert and our souls would be awake to your movement in our midst. And as our prayers build bridges between us and others, we pray that you would give us ears to hear the ways that you are calling us to service, that you would give us the courage to step out in faith as we care for one another. For we ask all of these things in the name of Christ, the one who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Friends, we know that we have been so abundantly blessed by our God, and as Christians, we want to use those blessings to bless others. There are offering plates at all the entrances and exits of this sanctuary, and we invite you to share what you've been given that we might share with others. Amen.
Through 13. Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he had finished, one of his disciples said, "Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples." And Jesus told them, "When you pray, say, 'Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." He also said to them, "Imagine that one of you has a friend, and you go to that friend because you have a friend who's come on a long journey has arrived. So you knock on their door and you say, 'Friend, loan me 3 loaves of bread. Another friend has come into town, and I have nothing to set before him.' And imagine further that he answers from within his house, 'Don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything.' But Jesus said, 'I assure you, even if he wouldn't get up and help because of his friendship, he will get up and give his friend whatever he needs because of his friend's brashness. And I tell you, ask and you will receive. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open to you. Everyone who asks receives. Whoever seeks finds. To everyone who knocks, the door is open. Which father among you would give a snake to your child if your child asked for a fish? If a child asks for an egg, What father would give that child a scorpion? If you who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Now that you're awake, we are continuing today our sermon series, Invitations from God. It's good to be back with you. I'm thankful to Pastor Ethan for offering the sermon last week while I was away, and for our wonderful ministry staff who always do a great job. But today we hear this invitation to prayer. My father was an accomplished musician, something that was typically overshadowed by the fact that on Sundays he didn't sit at the keyboard or the organ bench, but instead stood in the pulpit. At home, we had an upright piano, and I remember being delighted when I heard the strains of Bach floating into my room in the evening, because it meant that he had gotten home from work or whatever church meeting he had been at. And I loved hearing my father play the piano because it was something that he did just because he loved it. It wasn't work for him, it was pure joy. And so, after growing up for a few years, hearing him play so confidently and beautifully, I asked him a very important question. I said, "Daddy, will you teach me how to play like that?" He was happy that I had asked. He sat me down on the piano bench, my legs dangling, and he showed me how to find middle C. "Put your thumb here," he said, "and then press down." So I did, and a note sounded out full and rich. It was so beautiful. It was exciting. Then he taught me how to place my other fingers along the keys and slowly began to show me how to play. "Here we go, up a row to a birthday party." We got piano primers, and I began to learn how to identify the notes and match them with my fingers and the keyboard, and it was exciting. It really was, at first. But after a while, I became frustrated, you know? I had wanted to play like my father. I had wanted Bach or Beethoven, but instead I was getting bah, bah, black sheep. It was disappointing. I wanted to know, what was I doing wrong? Jesus' disciples were faithful Jews, which meant that they had a robust prayer life with prayers that they would pray at three different times during the day, every day. But as they began to follow Jesus, their conception of prayer may have shifted because they saw him pray at all sorts of times and in all sorts of circumstances. As you read the Gospel of Luke, we find Jesus praying constantly. He prays when he senses God's calling on his life. He prays before he chooses his first disciples. He prays as he heals people. He prays as he serves. He prays when he feels the pressures and demands of his ministry. He prays in the garden as he faces the cross, and he prays from the cross as he finishes his work. Prayer was this way of life for Jesus. It shaped everything that he did. He was connected to God in prayer at every moment as God empowered him to live the life that he was called to live. And the disciples saw that. The disciples saw the way that Jesus prayed. They saw the connection Jesus had with God. And over time, they realized that they wanted that sort of experience. They wanted that sort of relationship for themselves. And so they asked him a very important question. They said, "Lord, will you teach us how to pray?" Unlike at other times in Scripture when people requested things of Jesus that he was not willing to give, this request from Jesus' disciples is immediately granted. And the first thing that Jesus does is give his disciples some words. Like finding middle C with the thumb of your right hand on the keyboard, Jesus tells his disciples, "Here is where you begin. Start your prayer," Jesus says, "by considering who you are praying to." Prayer is, of course, not just talking to ourselves. So take time to consider who God is, as intimate and close to us as a loving parent, but also as holy and as transcendent as the heavens. So begin there. "Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed and holy be your name." Next, Jesus tells his disciples that before we pray for what we want to come true, we need to learn how to seek what God wants to be true. Because, of course, prayer is not just a list of our demands. Our prayers invite us to meditate on this question first. What does the Lord want to happen in me, in the world, in the church, in my family? What does the Lord require? What does God want? And even before we have all the answers to those questions, we surrender ourselves to them. Whatever we want for ourselves must be filtered through this desire that first and foremost, we want God's will to be done and God's glory to be manifest on earth as it is in heaven. To really mean this prayer means that we will pledge our lives to advancing God's reign. So we pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Even as we consider who God is and what God wants, Jesus also reminds us to consider our neighbors. Prayer is not, of course, just an individual endeavor. Jesus tells us that when we pray, we are never praying alone. We are praying alongside a community of believers, sometimes in unison together, like when we say the Lord's Prayer in worship, sometimes in different voices from different places. And when we pray for others, even as we pray for ourselves. Did you notice the pronouns Jesus uses? We pray that our daily needs would be met as well as the daily needs of others. Give us this day our daily bread. We pray that we would be forgiven and that we would also be given the courage and the grace to forgive others. Forgive us our sins as we forgive others who sin against us. We pray that God would protect us as we move through difficult moments, and that even when we face the hardest things in life, that we would not let go of our faith. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Jesus, this is the shape of prayer. It connects our lives with our Creator, and it connects our lives with others as we seek God's provision, God's forgiveness, and God's protection and fidelity. We know that this sort of prayer begins and ends with God and who God is, and so we now end our prayer with a reiteration of how we began. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus' disciples ask him to teach them to pray, and he gives them, were you okay? Friends, we have called an ambulance. She's on the phone. Would you join me in prayer? First, we'll pray silently. Let's pray. Gracious God, we know that you are with us wherever we are and whatever we are going through, and we ask now for your intervention, that you would surround this one with your healing, with your comfort, that you would direct those who can care for him well. We pray that you would be with us, Lord, as we lift him in prayer. Thank you for the ways that you are with us. Amen. So I would just encourage you to stay seated. We are going to wait for an ambulance, and we have someone that's going to direct the ambulance. And if you could just remain calm. Thank you. Well, friends, I would like for you to be praying for Stanley and his wife, Lillian. This was their first time here at this church. And so I'm thankful for all of you who were able to help in many different ways. That is one of the beautiful things about church, is that we can be with each other in hard moments and in scary moments. And so, well done. Thank you all. He will be taken to the hospital, but he is awake, as you saw him wave, and that is good, very good news. You can read my sermon. It'll be in the tie. And if you don't get the tie, you can sign up for the tie. But really, this sermon was a sermon about prayer. And Jesus teaches us, after he gives us the Lord's Prayer, that really prayer is about continuing to pray. It's about persistence, right? It's about banging on that door until you get an answer. And the answer that God says that he will give us is not always the thing that we ask for, but God always promises us the Holy Spirit, which is what empowers us to keep going when we face difficult things. And there's no better promise than that. And so we pray that for all those who are going to care for Stanley at the hospital. We thank God for the EMS, for the firefighters, and for all of you who are able to step in. And we will continue to pray for Stanley and his wife Lillian as we move through this week, and I will hope to have an update for you. But I would just encourage you to do what Jesus says. Keep praying. Keep praying. Not only for them, but for our world, for each other, and for ourselves. Amen. All right. I think we'll sing a closing hymn, okay? It's number 544, When Sorrow Floods the Troubled Heart. And as we sing, if you have a decision to make or you just need to come up and pray, we invite you to do that during this time. Let's stand together.
When so
Thank you for being a part of our service of worship this morning. I know it was more eventful than you had planned on. I'm thankful for each of you and for the prayers that I know you will be lifting for Stanley and Lillian and for one another as we move through this week. Remember all the ways that you can be involved in the life and ministry of our church and receive this blessing as you go. Go with us, Lord, that we might love and serve you in all that we do. Put our hands to work, move our feet, and help us to sense your calling. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.